Although we did not find clear evidence that Secretary Clinton or her colleagues intended to violate laws governing the handling of classified information, there is evidence that they were extremely careless in their handling of very sensitive, highly classified information. With respect to potential computer intrusion by hostile actors, we did not find direct evidence that Secretary Clinton's personal email domain, in its various configurations since 2009, was hacked successfully. But given the nature of the system and of the actors potentially involved, we assess we would be unlikely to see such direct evidence. We do assess that hostile actors gained access to the private commercial email accounts of people with whom Secretary Clinton was in regular contact from her personal account. In this case, given the importance of the matter, I think unusual transparency is in order. Although there is evidence of potential violations of the statutes regarding the handling of classified information, our judgment is that no reasonable prosecutor would bring such a case. We cannot find a case that would support bringing criminal charges on these facts. All the cases prosecuted involved some combination of clearly intentional and willful mishandling of classified information or vast quantities of information exposed in such a way as to support an inference of intentional misconduct, or indications of disloyalty to the United States, or efforts to obstruct justice. We do not see those things here.
The world hangs on every word our president says, and Donald Trump is simply unqualified and temperamentally unfit to be our president and commander-in-chief.
I'm here today because I believe in Hillary Clinton. And I want you to help elect her to be the next president of the United States of America. That's why I'm here.
Welcome to Foro Politico, Free and Independent. My name is Marcos Palma. We have a lot of issues to discuss. Today is July 6, 2016. It's over. No charges against Secretary Clinton regarding their emails. Yesterday, the FBI Director James Comey delivered a press conference where he said, even though there was a classified information between those emails, there was no intention to damage national security. All Americans, we were waiting for these results of that investigation. And yesterday, when everything looked like there would be some charges, at the end of the conference, Mr. Comey said, no criminal charges against the presumptive Democrat nominee. This was a bad news for the Republicans. They were waiting for a conviction. That way, Secretary Clinton would have to leave her presidential campaign. The conservative media was so upset. They were blaming the FBI director. Some of them say that was a dark day for justice. Also, they say the Clintons are above the law. 2 days later, the Congress called to testify Mr. Comey to explain what happened with this investigation. I have to tell you that after this press conference, Mr. Obama and Mrs. Clinton landed in Charlotte, North Carolina. They took the Air Force Ones, and they had been criticized for that. Later, we're going to show you part of this rally. I have to tell you that during the same day, but in the afternoon, Mr. Trump responded to this decision and said the system is rigged. He repeats, the system is rigged, the system is stupid. Talking about Mr. Trump, he keeps insulting people. This time, the youth community. During the 4th of July weekend, he tweeted a picture depicting the youth. In a few minutes, we will show the picture. In this program, we will talk about the latest polls for the presidential election 2016. And also, we will tell you why Secretary Clinton is calling Mr. Trump the king of death. Before this, we are going to talk about the situation in Mexico where hundreds of dissident teachers are protesting. They're demanding the resignation of Mr. Aurelio Nuño, the education minister. There has been protests in Oaxaca, in Guerrero, in Chiapas, and Mexico City. These teachers are requesting a dialogue with Mr. Nuño regarding the education reform. I have to tell you that in June 19, there were 11 people dead and 116 injured. This happened in Nochistlan, Oaxaca. There were some clashes between the police and the farmers. So far, there are no arrests and no explanation about what happened. We're going to start with this issue. We have in the phone a teacher from Huajuapan de León, Oaxaca. I will ask some questions in Spanish, and then we will talk with Antonio Arias, an immigrant advocate. Le quiero dar la bienvenida al profesor Efraín, quien nos toma la llamada desde Huajuapan de León, Oaxaca, precisamente para hablarnos acerca de este acontecimiento que se registra de estos profesores disidentes, quienes no aceptan la reforma educativa del presidente Peña. Y por cuestiones de seguridad, únicamente le damos el nombre de profesor como Efraín. Bienvenido, profesor. Díganos brevemente cuáles son sus demandas.
Buenas tardes a todas las personas que me escuchan allá en los Estados Unidos. Reciban ustedes un cordial saludo del gremio magisterial y del pueblo de Oaxaca. Bueno, nosotros tenemos en nuestro pliego petitorio nueve demandas fundamentales, pero lo podemos reducir a cinco, ¿verdad?, que son las elementales ahorita. Primero que nada, estamos exigiendo la cancelación o la abrogación de la reforma educativa. Es el punto central. Número dos, estamos exigiendo que a los compañeros normalistas que egresan de las normales se les asigne una plaza en lo inmediato, puesto que ahora con la reforma educativa se pretende que hagan un examen para que se les asigne, para que se les otorgue la plaza. Nosotros no coincidimos en eso. ¿Por qué no coincidimos en eso? Porque los jóvenes, cuando salen de la normal, presentan un examen y obtienen un certificado, y como su nombre lo indica, lo certifica para poder ejercer la docencia. Número tres, estamos exigiendo la liberación de nuestros presos políticos. Son presos de conciencia que los ministerios públicos les ejecutaron una orden de aprehensión, pero bajo lineamientos del gobierno federal. Número cuatro, exigimos que cese el hostigamiento y también las notificaciones a las compañeras y compañeros maestros que hoy no han cobrado durante tres quincenas por estas arbitrariedades del gobierno. Número cuatro, estamos exigiendo también que se dote a las escuelas del material necesario, de la infraestructura necesaria para poder llevar a cabo el proceso de aprendizaje en todas las escuelas de nuestro estado y del país. Básicamente podemos resumir nuestros puntos ahí, ¿verdad?, en esos aspectos. Pero la lucha fue precisamente como lo hemos denominado en esta jornada, por la defensa de la educación pública y el empleo.
El pasado 19 de junio en Nochistlán se registraron confrontaciones entre la Policía Federal y los residentes y algunos maestros. En esa ocasión se hablaba de 8 personas muertas y 160 heridos. Hasta el día de la grabación de hoy, 6 de julio, nos reportan 11 personas muertas. ¿Qué les dicen las autoridades? ¿Qué hay de las investigaciones?
Mire, no fue una confrontación. Fue un ataque directo que hicieron las fuerzas federales en contra de la población y en contra de los maestros. Nuestra toma de la carretera era pacífica, hasta que llegaron esas personas, primero con los toletes, con gas lacrimógenos, nos restringió retirar, pero después llegaron los pobladores de Nochistlán y otros pueblos circunvecinos, y entonces, pues al ser mayor número nosotros, los obligamos a replegarse, pero ellos sacaron armas de fuego y estuvieron disparando de manera totalmente indiscriminada, ¿verdad?, a quien le pegara. Entonces, ahorita tenemos en la actualidad 12 muertos. El último, un compañero que cayó el día de ayer, producto del desalojo del día 11 de junio, en el día por la ciudad de Oaxaca, cuando también fuimos agredidos por las fuerzas federales del gobierno, de este gobierno represor. Hasta el momento, nosotros estamos exigiendo el esclarecimiento de los hechos. Queremos que se castigue a los autores materiales e intelectuales de este atentado en contra de la población, puesto que no concebimos que un gobierno que se dice democrático por el hecho de defender sus derechos. Hasta el momento no hay avances en la investigación, hasta el momento no hay nada, la Comisión Nacional de Derechos Humanos ha intervenido, pero no sabemos hasta qué punto lleva la investigación. Eso es un poco, no nos hacemos muchas ilusiones de que va a haber justicia, puesto que ellos son juez y parte, ¿verdad? Entonces, pues creemos de que pues va a ser una justicia sesgada, o van a culpar a terceras personas, pero los principales en este caso, tendríamos que ver quiénes fueron los que dieron la orden para disparar. Si fue el secretario de Gobernación, Osorio Chong, si fue el secretario de Educación, Aurelio Nuño, o de quién vino la orden, porque esto vino de mandos muy arriba, que los policías simplemente obedecieron la orden.
Brevemente, profesor Efraín, que nos toma la llamada desde Huajuapan de León, Oaxaca, para hablarnos acerca de esta situación de los profesores. Háblenos brevemente acerca del abastecimiento de alimento y de productos básicos para esas poblaciones, porque los medios en México indican que no hay suficiente comida.
Esta es una gran falacia. Es una gran falacia porque hay suficiente abastecimiento en todo el estado de Oaxaca. Ya el José Antonio Meade, que es uno de los secretarios, no recuerdo, perdón, la secretaría, pero es encargada precisamente del abastecimiento hacia las poblaciones, hacia los estados. El día de ayer dijo que está cubierto en un 100% el estado de Oaxaca. Entonces, es una gran mentira que hoy se esté diciendo que hay desabasto en Oaxaca. A los carros que no se les permite pasar son a los carros de las transnacionales, como es la Coca, la Pepsi, Bimbo, Sabritas, o sea, comidas que no son indispensables en la dieta del mexicano, pero lo que es licor, lo que es el maíz, lo que es la leche, todos los productos están garantizados el paso libre para evitar precisamente el desabasto. Simplemente es una política del gobierno federal para desprestigiar el movimiento, que es un movimiento social ahora ya del pueblo, es un movimiento totalmente pacífico. Entonces, esto que están diciendo del desabasto es la gran mentira, ¿verdad? Es el gran engaño que, como siempre, el gobierno mexicano pretende hacer perder a la opinión pública nacional e internacional. El abasto en Oaxaca está garantizado al 100%.
No tenemos mucho tiempo, señor Efraín, nuevamente le repito, pero me gustaría preguntarle acerca de esta reunión programada para el próximo 11 de julio, donde se reúne nuevamente el secretario de Gobernación, Miguel Ángel Osorio Chong, con representantes de la CENTE. ¿Qué espera usted de eso?
Mire, es la cuarta reunión ya. Yo espero, sinceramente, deseamos los maestros que la Secretaría de Gobernación llegue con el ánimo de distender el problema, llegue con el ánimo de dar respuestas claras, respuestas satisfactorias a la sociedad. Es lo que estamos deseando todos en Oaxaca, es lo que deseamos todos en México, porque lo que menos queremos es que este problema siga más adelante. Entonces, está en manos del gobierno. El día viernes, el día lunes próximo, este gobierno, encabezado en este caso por Osorio Chong, da unas respuestas claras y satisfactorias para este movimiento, será algo bastante positivo que nos permita ayudar a destrabar el problema. Yo en lo particular espero eso, que haya una respuesta muy sensata, muy acorde a lo que está exigiendo este momento tan delicado para México.
Muchísimas gracias, profesor Efraín, que nos tomó la llamada desde Huajuapan de León. Vamos a estar al pendiente de los últimos acontecimientos acerca de esta situación de los profesores, de la reforma educativa y de que no vaya a haber la intervención de fuerzas en contra de esta población, la cual ya ha dejado varias víctimas. Gracias, profesor.
Le agradezco mucho, que tengan buenas tardes.
Now I want to welcome Mr. Antonio Arias. Mr. Antonio, tell us in a brief what happened in Oaxaca. How is the relation that you have with those teachers over there, where the incident happened, where 12 teachers have died and more than 100 injured?
We've been doing, as you know, humanitarian aid is the effort we do, especially with the deportees. And on that, you know, we help any place in Mexico or wherever there is a stress, social stress, trying to do whatever we can. We came in contact with Radio Mixteca, where that is located on the experimental Escuela Educacional Normal Experimental on Oaxapan Guerrero, on Oaxapan, Oaxaca, and then I came in contact with these teachers. What we've been doing is just trying to raise money to help the people who was hospitalized by donors from the United States, and also to help the people with the funerals. And the station where he works has been being helpful on that. So that's our involvement on, with the station and the teachers.
A few minutes ago, I interviewed this teacher from Oaxaca, mm-hmm. Huajuapan de León, and they're afraid about those actions by the government. They're afraid that they're going to repress them and use force to stop them to stop in those protests. Do you have that feeling?
Well, this is a fortunate and unfortunate, you know, situation that is happening. They've been privatizing and selling out all resources. Democracy, justice, everything has been being sacrificed, and they've been beating people, the people from the oil companies, the electricians, different separately. And this attack against the, we can say San Quintín is another one of the groups that they've been attacked separately and with no major result or major involvement from the population. This attack on the teachers has been being for several years, more than 10, but you know, very increase on its force in 2 years. And now on Nochistán, what happened is that they attacked the population. They came with helicopters, drop out grenades, you know, to crowd control, and then they hurt the population. The population unified themselves with the teachers in a single claim. Now the claim start being more widespread, and the support is more widespread. The government's got less space for maneuvering, but at the same time, the only thing it's got, you know, to justify the existence is force. So it may use it, but now the population is more looking at the state as an enemy. So things are getting hopeful, but then yet more dangerous.
You've been helping the immigrant community in Southern California. Now, are you planning to do something to help those teachers over there? Because we have seen also protests through the world, but also here in the United States, in Chicago, New York, and here in San Bernardino, and Los Angeles, upside to the Mexican councils. But are you planning to do what?
Well, with Guernica, Nunca Otra Vez, we've been being, helping mainly deportees and also working with Father Solalinde and other people, you know, humanitarian orientation in Mexico. On that, we try to help wherever there is social tensions, trying to see help and be useful in order to avoid, you know, bloodshed. We are humanitarian. We try to see if we can be useful, at least providing the most money or any other forms of help in order to alleviate the pain. We don't have yet the capacity for mediation, but you know, anything we do right here, we'll be trying to see if we can raise money and use the station as a way to channel it. We got contacts on Guerrero and other things that we've been doing work in order to channel humanitarian help, whatever is needed on Mexico, and depend with the help and support we have right here to our work.
Unfortunately, we don't have much time, Mr. Antonio Arias, but thank you very much for sharing this things that happened in Oaxaca, Mexico. Thank you very much.
Okay, gracias.
We're gonna take our first break, but I'll be right back. We're gonna talk about the latest, about the emails from Secretary Clinton and everything that comes around this presidential election 2016. I'll be right back. It was Tuesday, July the 5th, when the FBI Director James Comey called for a press conference. This is part of that.
Although we did not find clear evidence that Secretary Clinton or her colleagues intended to violate laws governing the handling of classified information, there is evidence that they were extremely careless in their handling of very sensitive, highly classified information. With respect to potential computer intrusion by hostile actors, we did not find direct evidence that Secretary Clinton's personal email domain, in its various configurations since 2009, was hacked successfully. But given the nature of the system and of the actors potentially involved, we assess we would be unlikely to see such direct evidence. We do assess that hostile actors gained access to the private commercial email accounts of people with whom Secretary Clinton was in regular contact from her personal account. In this case, given the importance of the matter, I think unusual transparency is in order. Although there is evidence of potential violations of the statutes regarding the handling of classified information, our judgment is that no reasonable prosecutor would bring such a case. We cannot find a case that would support bringing criminal charges on these facts. All the cases prosecuted involved some combination of clearly intentional and willful mishandling of classified information, or vast quantities of information exposed in such a way as to support an inference of intentional misconduct, or indications of disloyalty to the United States, or efforts to obstruct justice. We do not see those things here.
That press conference happened yesterday, July the 5th, and today the Justice Department said no charges against Secretary Clinton. That was by Loretta Lynch, the Justice Secretary. Now I want to welcome Mr. Figueroa, Steven Figueroa. You've been with us. Thank you very much for coming with us. And also I'm going to welcome Mrs. Baca, Victoria Baca. She's running for the 1st District in the city of Moreno Valley. Thank you very much for joining us again, Mrs. Baca. I'm going to ask you your reaction, Mr. Figueroa, about those declarations by Mr. Comey.
$20 million wasted. It's as simple as that. What we've learned is that Hillary Clinton's website is more safer than the IRS, who was hacked. What we've learned is more safer than the Office of Personnel Management. So it's a whole lot of nothing. That let's make something of it because it's politics. Did she make an error? She made an error. But you know what? She made the same error that Colin Powell made, same error that Condoleezza Rice made, same error that George Bush made. So it was common practice and not unheard of. Will it be done again? Of course not. Have they even proposed new laws of not to do that? No, they haven't. So they're still doing it.
Before this press conference, there was a meeting between Loretta Lynch, the Justice Secretary, and Mr. Clinton. Does that create some suspicions about that? Then on Tuesday, in July the 5th, the FBI director called for this press conference when he knew that later Mr. Clinton was going to be with Mrs. Clinton in North Carolina.
What appeared to be an appearance of impropriety was really nothing in itself. And it's two people passing in the mall saying, hey, how you doing? How can you not say hi to a friend?
Did you really think that happened?
Yeah, I really think that
happened.
That
they were talking about their grandchildren and about some family issues?
I firmly believe in that because the integrity of Mrs. Lynch that she underwent during the hearings proved that she had integrity. So, you know, it's a whole lot of nothing. We're talking politics, okay? Now, maybe now Bernie Sanders will not run and endorse her because I think he wasn't going to run for that. He was staying running for that purpose to see what's going to happen to Hillary.
Mr. Bernie Sanders was waiting for that decision to convict Mrs. Clinton, but did not happen. Mrs. Baca, your reaction also to this decision by the FBI director?
I'm not surprised by the decision. I'm just surprised that it took so long. I never felt that she had done anything wrong or criminal, I should say. Maybe she used bad judgment, but I don't know. And I believed her that, you know, she was doing her job, and I think she did an excellent job as a Secretary of State. And like Mr. Figueroa said, it's not unprecedented that someone uses their computer from home. It's just that she's the one that was accused and charges were brought against her, but hopefully now, I doubt it, but I'm hopeful that this can be put behind us and that we can move on and that the campaign can be, you know, a real campaign between issues. And again, you know, you have Mr. Trump that's just going to attack and, you know, call names and insult it because he really doesn't have substance to his campaign. So, and you have a very intelligent woman in Secretary Clinton, and it's going to be difficult for him. So he's going to have to look for new material, and he's going to, you know, be in a hot spot when it comes to national security, to national affairs, TPP. We have so much going on that I believe he's going to have a difficult time debating with an intelligent woman.
Even though the Justice Department has said that case closed,
yes.
Loretta Lynch.
Yes.
Day after Mr. Comey have that press conference.
Yes.
But Paul Ryan, the House Speaker, says that they will have to interrogate Mr. Comey in the Congress because they want more details about the investigation. Do you think that he still want to damage more Mrs. Clinton?
Absolutely.
And because legally, it looks like it's done.
It's
but
campaign.
Politically,
it's
different.
No, I think it's a witch hunt, and I believe that they're not going to let go because they feel they have something because they really don't have anything else. The Republicans don't have a good candidate. So they're going to try to damage Ms. Clinton and make her look bad for the Republican voters because they really don't have anything else.
One other thing that Republicans are talking about is the Clinton Foundation, that they say that they receive a lot of money mm-hmm. from those countries by Saudi Arabia and Qatar, other countries, that they receive money when they have violations for the human rights in those countries. And then they still, at the end of the day, it's a political fight between the Republicans and the Democrats. But what do you expect from that meeting from Mrs. Comey and the Congress, mostly the Republicans?
Well, they're gonna ask him questions regarding favoritism, special treatment, and not following protocol. That's all they can do, really, because he's hired to do a certain job, and he's doing his job.
I'm going to ask you the same question to Mr. Figueroa about the timing. The timing when these things happen at the 4th of July weekend. That said, first that Mr. Clinton got together with Mrs. Lynch, the Justice Secretary, and then on Tuesday, Mr. Comey says the press conference, and then that same day, but in the afternoon, Mr. Clinton and Ms. Clinton got together in North Carolina. They landed in the Air Force One.
Mm-hmm. Well, I believe that Mr. Comey and Loretta Lynch are independent of each other. I don't think that they're going to influence each other. But I think they're both going to respect each other's decisions, and they're both independent parties. And Mr. Clinton ran across Loretta Lynch. They ran across each other. And like they said, they know that they cannot influence the investigation. Perhaps they shouldn't have, because of the perception. People are like, ooh.
Only perception.
Perception.
Coming back to Mr. Figueroa, is Mr. Clinton helping his wife, Mrs. Clinton?
Bill's going to be Bill. But you know what? When he was president, we had no war. We had the best economy that we ever had. We had no deficit. And we were getting refunds from our taxes. So, he's going to help her. He's going to help her. He's going to provide great entertainment for Saturday Night Live.
But not with improprieties.
Right? But not with improprieties. But let's go back to Comey. Let's remember, FBI Director Comey is a conservative Republican, okay? Out to get Clinton. And he couldn't get her because there's nothing there. So we have to look at that. He's completely and separate, distinct from, Attorney General Lynch, who's a Democrat. So, there's nothing there. So tomorrow they're going to be holding hearings, I understand, saying, what do you mean by this and what do you mean by that? It's over. It's over. The only thing they're trying to do is keep a non-issue alive.
But Mr. Trump keeps repeating that the system is rigged.
Yeah, but let's remember, Donald Trump himself has rigged it in his favor. Every time he files bankruptcy and gets people to donate money and then he files bankruptcy. What idiot is going to give money to a billionaire to run for president, okay? He's got it rigged himself where he's paying himself back the money that he claims he's not paying. He's got it rigged himself when he takes millions of dollars from Saudi Arabia that treats women horrible and enslaves them, that takes money from Chinese that pay the Chinese companies that pay their wages below 25 cents an hour. So anybody who's rigging it is Donald Trump. And the best way, there's an old saying, the best way to describe Donald Trump is that this individual, he complains too much, he's taking the spotlight off himself.
In the past, we have seen that Mr. Trump have given money to Mrs. Clinton. Thanks. And also Mrs. Clinton went to one of his marriages, Mr. Trump. Right. What's your take on that?
What I think is politics makes for strange bedfellows. In 2 years, they may be at each other's parties.
We're enemies right now. I'm going to invite you to watch this clip from the Mr. Obama and Mrs. Clinton in North Carolina and Charlotte.
I'm here today because I believe in Hillary Clinton. And I want you to help elect her to be the next president of the United States of America. That's why I'm here. So maybe Hillary was surprised, but I wasn't surprised when I asked Hillary to represent our interests and our values around the world as America's Secretary of State. I knew she would do a great job. I knew she would perform. And I witnessed it in the Situation Room, where she argued in favor of the mission to get bin Laden. I saw how, as a former senator from New York, she knew, she understood, because she had seen it, she had witnessed it, what this would mean for the thousands who had lost loved ones when the Twin Towers fell. Everybody's got an opinion, but nobody actually knows the job until you're sitting behind the desk. Everybody can tweet, but nobody actually knows what it takes to do the job until you sat behind the desk.
Your reaction, Mrs. Baca, to that clip from Mr. Obama?
I love it. I love it. And, you know, I've been a Clinton supporter 8 years ago when she was running against Obama, and I know that they were campaigning against each other just like Clinton is campaigning against Bernie Sanders today. And what I liked about her is the class she had, that when Obama won the nomination, that she took a step back and supported Mr. Obama 100%. I would like to see that from Bernie Sanders.
Can we see a continuation of the Obama policies with Mrs. Clinton?
No, I think Mrs. Clinton is her own woman. And there are areas that she disagreed with Obama in foreign policy as well as domestic policy. Will there be some policies continue? I think she'll approve health Obamacare. I think she'll approve it. Because remember, it was her idea originally. I think that we're going to have more mental health care. I think she's going to be stricter on gun control than Obama.
Mr. Trump has mentioned that all the supporters for Bernie, they're welcome to his party, GOP.
Naturally.
Do you think that will happen instead of going with the Democrats? They will go with Mr. Trump?
No, we have, you know, the Democratic Party, we support, you know, a lot of civil liberties that the Republican Party does not support. For example, you know, we're all the way to the left, or we're moderates, you know, because a lot of us, you know, are Catholics and we're conservative, but we'll never be Republicans. No, that's not going to happen. Of course, he says it's welcome. You know, and we say welcome to the Republicans. Come and, you know, join the right party, you know. But no.
We're going to take another break, but I'll be right back. You're watching Foro Politico, free and independent. Thank you for joining us. Now we're going to show you this part of the speech by Hillary Clinton. She was in North Carolina, Charlotte.
President Obama's job, one that he did not ask for but was handed to him, was to save us from a second Great Depression, and that is exactly what he did. I don't think he gets the credit he deserves for saving our economy. We've added 14 million private sector jobs. The auto industry just had its best year ever. 20 million people now have health care. Clean energy production has soared. I could go on and on, but you get the idea. That is what leadership looks like. We have to continue to take on deep structural challenges that existed long before the Great Recession. We see it here in North Carolina and across the country. Inequality is too high, wages are too low, and it's just too hard to get ahead. We need an economy that works for everyone, not just those at the top. Donald Trump thinks wages are too high. He actually stood on the debate stage and said that. And he wants to get rid of the federal minimum wage altogether. Well, I think anyone who is willing to work hard should be able to find a job that pays well enough to raise a family. So we're going to increase the federal minimum wage and give the middle class a raise. The world hangs on every word our president says, and Donald Trump is simply unqualified and temperamentally unfit to be our president and commander-in-chief.
Unqualified and not tempered to be the commander-in-chief, Mr. Figueroa.
I believe that's an understatement. Unqualified, temperamental, I believe with deep psychological problems. We cannot have a racist who supports the Ku Klux Klan in the presidency.
What can you tell me about trustworthy, honesty between the two candidates?
A man who plans to file bankruptcy is not trustworthy because he takes advantage of small business, and I'm a small business supporter. So he gets the pension funds of all these individuals invested in his projects, takes the money, and then makes sure he gets paid good, and then files bankruptcy. As far as trustworthiness on the other side, you know what? There's a lot of dirty hands here. We're not going to deny that. Okay?
Talking about honesty, Mrs. Baca, man or woman trustworthy? Who's more honest in this case? We've seen that the Secretary Clinton, she's traveling around the world. She has seen many things. And she was, as you said, a very good Secretary of State. But now to be a president of the United States, the first woman, is she going to recover from these scandals? First, Benghazi, then the emails?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. She will recover from that, just like she recovered from supporting her husband when he was, you know, being unfaithful to her, and she stood by him. You know, a lot of people don't like it, but, you know, that's her private life, and she stood by her man. But as far as trustworthy, I think that she is trustworthy. You know, with the computer issue, the emails, maybe she didn't use or believe that she was doing anything that her predecessors hadn't done. You know, no one complained about them. It's just when it became a Democratic issue and a witch hunt. And as far as unqualified, I think that Mr. Trump is unqualified, and I agree with Secretary Clinton that he is ill-tempered. You know, he loses it, and then he starts attacking. He doesn't. There's no thought process. He's not prepared. He shoots from the hip, and I don't think that that's what the people of America want at the United Nations when he's you know, a diplomat visiting other countries and representing us. I don't think that's what we want, and that's why I believe that he is not going to win, because not even the Republicans want him, but he's the presumptive Republican nominee, so they're supporting him. But ahead, you know, you could look months behind. The Trumps didn't want him. You know, Marco Rubio wasn't supporting him.
You're running a campaign in the city of Moreno Valley for the first district for the city council. Have you faced any nasty attacks, any dirty campaign so far?
In this campaign, no, it's been very positive. But in the past, you know, I was recalled in 2014, due to a you know, false allegations, false raids, and in a very dirty, dirty campaign by a woman that actually was nominated, you know, elected to be the councilwoman. And just recently, she announced, you know, in public that she's a convicted felon.
I'm asking you this because it should be painful. It should be painful when somebody's talking about you publicly. Let's say, this woman is this and this and this, and then that's painful.
Yeah, it is, but I understand, you know, I can separate myself. I know that this is politics and that they're going to do everything they can because I'm the candidate to beat. So they had to do all these things, make, you know, the false allegations, say I'm being investigated by the FBI, the IRS, the district attorney, and it took 2 years. And, you know, they when they went to my house, they took nothing, whereas other council people, they took their laptops, their copiers, their telephones, and what have you. I didn't have anything. I was nominated in November. I was sworn in December. I took office in January, and they raided my house in April. So I'm like, what's going on here? And it really was a witch hunt.
Well, those attacks, they're very seriously when you're running for political positions.
You ask yourself, who has money and power to do something like this?
And that's why I'm going to show you this picture, the campaign for Mr. Trump sent this picture where Secretary Clinton is on top of the lot of $100 bills and David Starr. Let's watch this picture. Let's tell me, what do you think about, well, it's the other one. It's the picture where they had the Star of David. It's not, they changed it to this picture. But tell me, Mr. Figueroa, what's your take on that? Well, first of all, Mr. Trump sent the picture with the David Star, and then he changed to that picture that we showed you that has the circle.
What it should be saying is that Trump is a Nazi, and here's the proof. He took a page right out of Hitler. In fact, that is what the Nazi Party what did with the face of a Jewish man in the 1930s. They put the Star of David, and they criticized them. They criticized their facial expression, their money, the way they worked. It's right out of a page of Hitler. And what I'm saying is, American public, see what you see. And if you vote for Donald Trump, then what else we to say is that you support the Nazis.
Then you don't take it as a mistake. You think that picture was intentional.
It was definitely intentional. Once a bell was toned, you can't unring it. Okay, and it was toned. It was there to send a message to his right-wing supporters. And let's remember, even the Koch brothers, right-wing fascist Koch brothers, say Donald Trump is too far to the right.
When you go to that level, to that kind of nasty campaign,
no,
what's next?
No, I don't do that. I run on my merits, and I'm the one that is attacked because the other candidate or the other side don't have any substance to their campaign. What can they say? I've been involved in politics since 1993, 92.
Can we expect more nasty things through the next few months before November?
Yes, yes.
Because of Mr. Trump, the way he is?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think this is just the beginning. That Mr. Trump is, going to have a very strong negative campaign against Secretary Clinton.
So far, do you think Secretary Clinton is defended the right way? She's doing the right way?
Even though
she's spending more money in ads than Mr. Trump.
Yes. Yeah, she's doing a good job, and I think that she's sticking to the issues. I like that about her. And, once in a while she'll say that, he's nuts. And, I think we need to do that because we need to address what he's doing. We can't just let it go. That would be a mistake. So when, he says, corrupt person, she needs to come out and show what she has done. And, she's done a lot for this country, more so than Donald Trump. What has he done for the country? What has he done? He's always been someone that depends on profits, whereas she's been a public servant.
But even though she's a woman and Mr. Trump, I cannot imagine then in a debate, because the way that Mr. Trump is, when he's insulting a lot of people, and how is it going to happen?
We still don't like it.
What have you seen in the debates?
Yeah, as Americans, we're still in the infant stage, for example, with having women in the military, with having women in the battlefields, in the front line. We're still babies when it comes to that. And we've never had a female nominee. We've never had a female presidential candidate. So we're still infants in that. And we're going to have to, deal with it. And she has to deal with it. And she's very thick-skinned. She's very intelligent. And I think that she will fire back, and she will defend herself. She will be able to do that.
Even though in your campaign that you're running in Moreno Valley, do you have the feeling that woman still does not belong to the public arena?
Oh, no, not at all. I've never felt that way.
Okay. I'm going to show you another picture. This picture is about a man that is doing a kind of business in the Coachella Valley using that slogan for Mr. Trump. It's called Make America Great. Let's watch. What do you think about that, Mr. Figueroa? This is a billboard. It's in the Coachella Valley, and this is a palm shop over there in the Southern California. And I would like to ask you about that picture.
When I look at that, I think of ignorance. America is great, always been great. For those people who want to make America great again, then I'm telling him.
But look, it says, but a legal immigrant to the USA.
All right. What can you do? I'll tell him that he didn't study his constitution to become a US citizen because it's made up of immigrants, and it's been made up of illegal immigrants since the founding of this country. When this constitution was founded, 2/3 of the people that lived here were here illegally. So he's ignorant. And I would tell him to his face that he could go back to his country, that we made a mistake.
Then the owner of that picture is taking advantage of that.
No,
the slogan, or
no? I think the owner, he's ignorant, and I would tell him to his face he can go back to his country. We made a mistake in admitting him.
Do you take like an insult to the immigrants here?
Absolutely, it's meant to do that. It is meant to cross controversy and to hurt somebody. If I were to put on there, we were to go spray paint KKK up there, I'm sure he'd be happy.
What's your reaction to that, Mrs. Baca, about the billboard that we showed you?
Well, I think that. I agree with Mr. Figueroa. I think that America is great. I mean, we're always improving. We're always better. I think that we're a world power. I think that the world respects us as a country. I mean, we're not always going to get 100% agreement. But you have someone that, you know, it's ridiculous.
But do you think that in this case, can we talk about to not going to buy products or consume this product from this company?
Absolutely. You know, boycotts work. I boycott. Yeah. I target my dollars. And I let the people know when they offend me, I'm not coming to your shop, and I'm going to tell my friends. It works. And I do it. And when I post something on Facebook,
Have that billboard in your area, in your neighborhood, what would you do it?
I'd be protesting them right outside that shop.
We would.
I'd give him all the negative advertisement that he wants.
What about you, Miss?
I would be there right beside my brother.
Because nothing happened in the beautiful Coachella Valley. No people speak out. Nobody's saying nothing.
Yeah.
Nobody's,
yeah. Wow. Well, you know, I'll tell you that in Moreno Valley, we have a lot of community activists. And I've trained parents, and I know that when something happens, we organize and we take care of it. That would not stand in Moreno Valley just like a sign, and everybody's like, oh, look, how nice. No, that wouldn't happen.
Then this will be part of our culture that nobody protests,
well,
nobody says
well,
nothing.
Well, this is the great, he's an ignorant immigrant, is what I would say. And unfortunately, sometimes we allow the wrong people into this country like him. We should be allowing these families who are working and trying to do stuff. He's a pawn shop. What can we expect from a pawn shop owner, you know?
But do you think with that billboard, he's supporting Mr. Trump?
Yeah, absolutely. He's supporting more than Trump, okay? He's basically, he's trying to get business by creating controversy.
And he really does. Yeah. We're going to have to take another break.
Okay.
We're going to take another break, but you're watching Foro Politico. Thank you. Thank you for joining us once again. In this segment, we're going to talk about a shooting that happened in Louisiana where two police officers killed another African-American. This happened 2 days ago, and the name of the victim is Alton Sterling. And we can see that once again, the police brutality is in against the African-American. Mr. Figueroa, you've been taking these cases. You've been involved a lot on civil protests because of this action. Is this because of the hate speech by Mr. Trump, the terrorist attacks? What's going on? What happened?
Obviously, it's not just this innocent man being shot while his hands were being held down, point blank, 2 inches. Thank God the Department of Justice has already initiated an investigation across. It is what it is. We saw what we saw. But in Ohio, we had an Arab man who was simply dressed in Arab clothing. The police went in with guns and raids and beat him up. And he was only a tourist because they thought, oh, he might have a bomb. He looks Arab. So what we have is a heightened state of alertness and panic and just a mob mentality going on where if you're a person of color, you look different. Right now, you're just like the people that Mr. Pawn Shop owner over there is inciting people along with Donald Trump.
But by the other side, Mr. Figueroa, we have to recognize the job from the police officers because when we have a good police officers, well-trained, by the other side, we have bad police officers. Do you think that this is a case or this is goes beyond the situation?
Obviously.
That they do not know how to handle situations like this, even though we have seen the video.
First of all, obvious not trained enough. Not doing psychological backgrounds enough. And these good officers have got to start standing up to this 1% of the bad officers. I believe that 99% are fantastic. But but they've got to be fantastic enough to say, hey, you're making us look bad. You break the law, you taking off your badge there, and you're going to be held accountable. I was in the Taisha Miller Steering Committee. I was arrested for blocking the police department. I worked on the Daryl Luckett case, and he was shot point blank by the sheriff's department in Bellflower. I've been involved in numerous cases. A high school friend of mine in Downey who was machine gunned down by the Downey police. That case settled for $4.5 million. So I've been involved in multiple cases over
the years. Is this has to any relation with the first president, the first African-American president? Do you think that hate, the racism is worse than before? Because we haven't seen like this before, that a lot of African-Americans killed by white police.
I think that's a fair statement. Since President Obama has become president, I can't believe some of my so-called friends, the racist comments that they make. And it's really, and I've confronted them and said, you know, that's racist. That's a bigot statement. And we've got to learn to start doing that. Because they do it to us. They say, this is America, speak English. So I can say, I can speak whatever language I want, you bigot.
Mrs. Paca, going back to you, since you're running for this campaign in Louisiana where this shooting happened, there are people asking for the resignation of the mayor and the chief of the police. If you become a member of the city council, would you do the same to, or what is the relation between the mayor and the police officer?
You know, being on the city council, I can say that there's an investigation needs to take place because, you know, our first reaction, of course, you know, one of our fathers or one of our brothers, you know, has been killed by the police, right? And it's initial reaction. But, you know, I was involved with the Taisha Miller campaign, and I know that there was lawsuits, and I was involved when the sheriffs were pursuing the truck that was carrying the immigrants that were
Temecula, 1994, 1995?
Yes, I was the only non-media or police officer in the press conference at that time, representing the Mexican Political Association at that time. And we had major protests, and, you know, the officers were, you know, found, you know, innocent. And they were released.
It's amazing.
We have no...
I was there. Mike Chinaco, the U.S. attorney, telling us, they were found innocent because they only got beat up for 16 seconds. Had they gone for three more seconds, then they would have been arrested. Yeah. Amazing the way these people think.
Yeah. They didn't break any laws.
We have no more time, 20 seconds. What can we expect in the Republican and Democrat convention? 20 seconds.
Well, I think that we're going to have a lot of gibberish coming out of the Republicans. Yes, I'm biased, and I think that Hillary Clinton's going to do an absolutely phenomenal job.
20 seconds.
Really quick. Cleveland is just taking out $59 million in insurance. There's going to be riots. People are out there ready to protest.
Are you going?
Donald Trump.
Are you going?
Am I going? It's a possibility, but, you know, it's going to my TV.
Thank you very much with us in this Foro Politico. Thank you.
Thank you.
On behalf of everybody that makes possible Foro Politico, thank you very much. Good night and see you soon.